The Holy Qur'an, a divine scripture, was sent down to mankind 14 centuries ago. From the day of its revelation to the day of judgment, it will remain as the last and sole guide for humanity. There are countless proofs that the Qur'an is the word of God. Such examples are its literary qualities that no human being can imitate, the fact that it is free of all inconsistency, and the way it foretells the future and contains certain hidden information. The Qur'an contains another miracle that proves it to be God's revelation. There are a remarkable number of scientific truths that are contained in it. In this book that was revealed over 14 centuries ago, there are innumerable examples of information which humanity has only been able to uncover using today's technology. People at that time were devoid of science. Conceptions of the nature and the universe were based on superstition and myth. For example, the Arabs supposed that the earth was flat and that mountains supported the sky above. Yet, all these superstitious beliefs were eradicated with the revelation of the Qur'an. The verse, "God is He who raised up the heavens without any support," invalidated the false beliefs of the Arabs regarding the sky. The Qur'an contains information on a great many subjects that nobody could have known at the time, from the creation of the universe to the making of man, from the structure of the atmosphere to the balances on Earth. Recent scientific discoveries have shown just how miraculous this information is. In the early 20th century, the prevalent view across the world was that the universe was infinite. According to this view, known as the static universe model, the universe had no end or beginning. This view dominated the scientific world for many years. This was the case until the evidence for a theory rocked this erroneous belief. The Big Bang Theory. The evidence proved that an explosion emanated from a single point some 15 billion years ago from nothingness. The entire universe, together with matter and time, came into existence as a result of a great explosion that occurred a long time ago. Many scientific findings today support the Big Bang Theory. It has now been proved that the universe had a beginning and was brought into being from nothing through a huge explosion. This fact, proved as the result of long research in the field of physics, was also declared 14 centuries ago in the Noble Qur'an. He created the heavens and the earth from nothing. Research carried out thanks to modern-day advanced technology, observation, and calculation have shed light on many secrets concerning the universe. One of these is the fact that it is constantly expanding. This idea of expansion was first raised in the early 20th century. The Russian physicist Alexander Friedman and the Belgian cosmologist Georges Lemaître theoretically calculated that the universe is in constant motion and that it is expanding. This notion was confirmed by the use of observational data in 1929. While observing the sky with a telescope, Edwin Hubble, the American astronomer, discovered a surprising fact. The stars and galaxies were constantly moving away from each other. This discovery is regarded as one of the greatest in the history of astronomy. A universe where everything constantly moves away from everything else implied a constantly expanding universe. Bodies in the universe were like points on the surface of a balloon being inflated. The more a balloon is inflated, the further away the points on its surface move from one another. Similarly, celestial bodies also move away from one another as the universe expands. There was no technology and no science of astronomy 14 centuries ago when the Qur'an was revealed. Nobody was then aware of this fact. Yet, it was clearly stated in Qur'anic verses that the universe was expanding. And it is we who have constructed the heavens with might, and verily it is we who are steadily expanding it. The human body. A flawless structure with many fine details that still have yet to be discovered. Scientists engaged in research using today's advanced technology obtained astonishing results concerning the human body. One of these dealt with the tissues in the body. Living tissues contain 26 different elements. Six of these are the most common: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. These basic elements represent 95% of all tissues. This, in turn, represents important scientific evidence of the information revealed in the Qur'an, the creation of man out of clay. The building blocks that constitute almost all the human body are present in the soil, either in free or compound forms. The first human being was created by God, who shaped clay into human form and breathed the soul into it. This miraculous event is described in the Qur'an. Your Lord said to the angels, "I am going to create a human being out of clay. When I have formed him and breathed my spirit into him, fall down in prostration to him." In another verse, God tells us that we created man from an extract of clay. The Arabic word sulala, translated as extract in the verse, means representative example or essence. The information revealed in the Quran 1400 years ago confirms what modern science tells us: the fact that the same elements are employed in human creation as those found in the soil. Let us now consider all those human beings who have ever lived and who are living today. Every person has his or her own set of fingerprints. Even identical twins having the very same DNA sequence have different fingerprints. That is because there is a special formation in the fingerprints. Fingerprints attain their final shape before birth and remain the same for a lifetime unless a permanent scar appears. That is why fingerprints are accepted as a very important proof of identity, exclusive to their owner. Scientists discovered this important feature only in the later 19th century. However, in the Qur'an, God points to the fingertips, which did not attract anyone's attention at that time, and calls our attention to their importance. Does man imagine we will not reassemble his bones? Yes, we are able to put together in perfect order the very tips of his fingers. He has created the heavens and the earth for truth. He wraps the night up in the day, and wraps the day up in the night. The Arabic word that is translated as to wrap in this verse is yukawir. In English, it translates as to make one thing lap over another, folded up as a garment that is laid away. The information given in the verse about the day and the night wrapping each other up includes accurate information about the shape of the world. This can be true only if the earth is round. However, it was then thought that the world was a flat plane. Nobody knew that the earth was round. The revelation in the Qur'an at that time that the earth was round is one of the countless proofs that our holy book is the Word of God. A very important feature of mountains is indicated in a Quranic verse. The function of preventing shocks in the earth. We placed firmly embedded mountains on the earth so it would not move under them. And geology today confirms this characteristic of mountains. Formerly, it was thought that mountains were merely protrusions rising above the surface of the earth. However, in the 20th century, scientists realized that this was not actually the case. Those parts known as mountain root extended down as far as 10 to 15 times their own height. For example, Mount Everest, the summit of which stands approximately 9 kilometers above the surface of the earth, has a root deeper than 125 kilometers. Mountains emerge as a result of the movements and collisions of massive plates forming the earth's crust. When two plates collide, the stronger one slides under the other. The one on the top bends and forms heights and mountains. The layer beneath proceeds under the ground and makes a deep extension downwards. These extensions are the mountain roots. Thanks to their roots, mountains fix the Earth's crust. Therefore, they prevent any sliding over the magma layer or amongst the layers themselves, and also prevent major earth tremors. With these features, mountains can be compared to nails holding strips of wood together. God tells us in the Qur'an, "Haven't we made the earth as a bed, and the mountains its pegs?" The fact that this function was revealed in the Qur'an at a time when it was unknown to anyone is another of this divine book's great miracles. Were it not for the fixing effect of the mountains, soil would not collect on the earth's surface, water would not accumulate in the soil, no plants could grow. In short, life on earth would be impossible. Through the mercy of God, however, the earth is capable of sustaining life. Sperm undertake a journey into the mother's body until they reach the ovum. Only 1,000 out of 250 million sperm succeed in reaching the ovum. At the end of this 5-minute race, the ovum, half the size of a grain of salt, will let only one of the sperm in. However, this finding that was determined in our own day reveals something that was previously unknown. That is, the substance of man is not the whole semen, but only a small part of it. This is explained in the Quran as follows. Does man reckon he will be left uncontrolled without purpose? Was he not once a drop of ejected semen? As close inspection shows, we are informed in the Quran that man is made not from the entire semen, but only a small part of it. This is also what modern science says. He creates you stage by stage in your mother's wombs in threefold darkness. That is God, your Lord. Sovereignty is His. There is no deity but Him. So what has made you deviate? Modern biology has revealed that the embryological development of the baby takes place in the manner revealed in the verse. The expression, a threefold darkness, indicates three dark regions involved during the development of the embryo. These are the darkness of the abdomen, the darkness of the womb, and the darkness of the placenta. It is also pointed out in this verse that a human being is created in the mother's womb in three distinct stages. In basic human embryology, a fundamental reference text in embryology, this fact is stated as follows. The life in the uterus has three stages: pre-embryonic, first 2.5 weeks, embryonic, until the end of the 8th week, and fetal, from the 8th week to labor. Information on the development in the mother's womb became available only after observations with modern devices. Yet, just like many other scientific facts, in a miraculous way, God draws our attention to these items of information in the verses of the Qur'an. The fact that such detailed and accurate information was given in the Qur'an at a time when people had scarce information on medical matters is clear evidence that it is the Word of God. The development of a human being in its mother's womb is full of miracles. The fetus's ears began to develop as early as the 22nd day of pregnancy and become fully functional in the 4th month. After that, the fetus can hear sounds in the mother's womb. For that reason, the sense of hearing forms before the other vital functions for a newborn baby. The order set out in the Qur'an is striking from that point of view. It is He who has created hearing, sight, and minds for you. What little thanks you show! God brought you out of your mother's wombs, knowing nothing at all, and gave you hearing, sight, and minds so that perhaps you would show thanks. Close examination shows that the senses God refers to in the Qur'an are always mentioned in a particular order. Hearing, sight, and understanding. That is exactly the same order in which a baby's senses develop. In short, one of the discoveries of modern science, the order of development of human organs, is clearly stated in the Qur'an. There are more than 100 billion galaxies in the visible universe, and each small galaxy contains approximately 1 billion stars. Furthermore, each big galaxy contains more than 1 trillion. Many of these stars have planets, and many of these planets have satellites. All these celestial bodies follow the most finely calculated paths and orbits for millions of years. Stars, planets, and satellites all rotate around their own axes, and also rotate together with the system of which they are a part. The universe functions within an order, just like the wheels in a factory. The movement of celestial bodies in their orbits is based upon extreme fine-tuning. Even the slightest deviation from their paths could have drastic consequences that might spell the end of the entire system. For example, the consequences of the Earth's deviating from its course by a mere 3 millimeters have been described in one source as follows. While rotating around the Sun, the Earth follows such an orbit that every 18 miles it only deviates 2.8 millimeters from a direct course. The orbit followed by the Earth never changes, because even a deviation of 3 millimeters would cause catastrophic disasters. If the deviation were 2.5 millimeters instead of 2.8 millimeters, then the orbit would be very large and all of us would freeze. If the deviation were 3.1 millimeters, we would be scorched to death. These facts were only discovered through astronomical research in the 20th century. Yet it was revealed 14 centuries ago in the Qur'an that heavenly bodies revolve in very finely tuned orbits. I swear by heaven with its oscillating orbits. In another verse we are told that it is He who created night and day and the sun and moon, each one swimming in a sphere. According to astronomers' calculations, the sun moves along a path known as the solar apex in the path of a star, Vega. This is just as revealed in the Qur'an. And the sun runs to its resting place. At the time of the revelation of the Qur'an, mankind definitely did not possess telescopes with which to gaze on outer space, millions of kilometers away, observation technology, or the modern sciences of physics and astronomy. Therefore, it was impossible at that time to scientifically determine that space was equipped with oscillating orbits. However, this fact is clearly stated in the Qur'an, which was sent down at that time, because the Qur'an is the word of God. In the honeybee colonies, where each of the many bees is assigned a specific task, the only exception is the male honeybee. The males do not contribute to the cleaning of the hive, to gathering food, or to making of the honeycomb and honey. The only function of the male bees in the hive is to inseminate the queen bee. The males possess almost none of the features possessed by the other bees. The worker bees carry the entire load of the colony. They have several duties: cleaning the hive, maintaining the larvae and the young, feeding the other bees, gathering supplies like nectar, pollen, water, and resin, and storing these in the hive. Although they are females like the queen, their ovaries have not developed. This renders them sterile. The features of these creatures are described in the Qur'an in Surat An-Nahl, which means the honeybee. Your Lord revealed to the bees, "Build dwellings in the mountains and the trees, and also in the structures which men erect. Then eat from every kind of fruit, and travel the paths of your Lord, which have been made easy for you to follow. From inside them comes a drink of varying colors containing healing for humanity. There is certainly a sign in that for people who reflect." This verse contains an important secret that can only be understood by means of Arabic grammar. In Arabic, there are two different usages of verbs. By means of the usage, it is possible to determine whether the subject is a female or a male. As a matter of fact, the verbs used for the honeybee in the verses are used in the format of the verb for females. Through this, it is indicated that the honeybees that work in the making of honey are females. It must not be forgotten that gender in insects was only understood through modern biological observations. The fact that the worker bees are all female was only established in our day. Yet God shows another miracle of the Quran by drawing our attention to this fact in verses. Today, the relativity of time is a proven scientific fact. This was revealed by Einstein's theory of relativity during the early part of the 20th century. Until then, it was not known that time was relative, nor that it could change according to the circumstances. Yet, the renowned scientist, Albert Einstein, proved this fact by showing that time is dependent on mass and velocity. However, the Quran, revealed some 1300 years before Einstein, had already included information about time as being relative. A day with your Lord is equivalent to 1,000 years in the way you count. He directs the whole affair from heaven to earth. Then it will again ascend to him on a day whose length is 1,000 years by the way you measure. The Big Bang theory, which the scientific world unanimously accepted in the 20th century, proves that the universe came into being with a giant explosion. One verse of the Quran that revealed this fact 1400 years ago reads, "Do not the unbelievers see that the heavens and the earth were sewn together, and then we unstitched them, and that we made from water every living thing? So will they not believe?" The word rakt, translated as sewn together, means mixed in each, blended, in the Arabic vernacular. The phrase, "we unstitched," is the verb fataka, and in Arabic it implies the tearing apart of a structure of things that are sewn to one another, A very important scientific fact is being described here, the separation of the heavens and the earth. Intriguingly, at the first moments of the Big Bang, the entire matter of the universe collected at one single point. The heavens and earth, which were not created yet, were within this single point. Then, this point exploded violently, causing its matter to disunite. This is just as is described in the verse. People 14 centuries ago, of course, possessed no scientific knowledge or technology by which to know that the Earth, the Sun, the Moon, the stars, and everything they saw, or that which was invisible in the skies, had initially been united in a single point. In the Qur'an, God calls our attention to a very important attribute of the sky. We made the sky a preserved and protected roof, yet still they turn away from our signs. The protective nature of the sky revealed in the Qur'an was only discovered in our own time. The atmosphere surrounding the earth protects us from lethal dangers. While destroying many meteors, big and small, as they approach the earth, it prevents them from falling to earth and harming life. It filters the light rays coming from space that are harmful to living things. It also protects the Earth from the freezing cold of the space, which is approximately minus 270 degrees Celsius. In addition to the atmosphere, there is another layer caused by the magnetic field of the Earth, which serves as a shield against the harmful radiation that threatens our planet. The Van Allen Belts. Thanks to the Van Allen Belts, the massive outbursts of energy called solar flares that frequently occur in the sun do not destroy life on Earth. In short, a perfect system is at work high above the Earth. It surrounds our world and protects it against external threats. Strikingly, this was revealed 1400 years ago in the Qur'an. Another verse imparting the same information reads, "It is He who made the earth a couch for you, and the sky a dome." Here the sky is described as Al-Sama Bina in Arabic, as well as the meaning of dome or ceiling. This word has another meaning. It also describes a kind of tent-like covering used by the Arab Bedouin. By describing the sky as a tent-like structure, the Qur'an is emphasizing that it is a form of protection against external elements. This is the protection the atmosphere affords against meteors and cosmic rays. All these facts show that this information obtained by humanity as the result of lengthy scientific research was imparted 1400 years ago in the Qur'an, when there were no spacecrafts or giant telescopes. The outer layer of the Earth's atmosphere consists of a great many gases, particularly oxygen. However, Energy explosions on the sun cause some of these gases to disperse into space. Researchers have obtained its first concrete evidence thanks to the NASA spacecraft. It was first observed that the Earth experiences a loss of matter from its outer layers on September 24th and 25th, 1998. In other words, this occurred 14 centuries after this information was imparted in the Qur'an. Don't they see how we come to the land, eroding it at its extremities? These verses may also be referring to the loss of land on Earth in another regard. At the present time, the polar ice caps are melting and the water level in the oceans is rising. As coastal areas come underwater, the land surface or total amount of land is decreasing. The expression, eroding it from its extremities in the verses, may well be pointing to coastal areas being covered by water. God knows best. The British physicist Paul Dirac, who won the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1933, made a most important discovery. This finding, known as parity, revealed the duality known as matter and antimatter. Antimatter bears the opposite characteristics to matter. For instance, contrary to matter, antimatter electrons have a positive charge, while protons have a negative electric charge. Nobody was aware of this scientific fact when the Qur'an was revealed 1400 years ago. Yet, it was clearly revealed in verses that everything in the universe has been created in pairs. A verse in the Qur'an shows this as follows. Glory be to Him who created all the pairs, from what the earth produces and from themselves and from things unknown to them. Up until 20 years ago, it was believed that the smallest particles were the protons and neutrons that comprise the atom. However, advances in science and technology disproved this. It was realized that the atom, regarded as the smallest unit of matter, could be divided into even smaller subcomponents. A specialized branch of physics emerged to study these subparticles and their particular behavior. Particle physics. Particle physics research has revealed that the protons and the neutrons that comprise the atom actually consist of subparticles known as quarks. This fact only emerged in the last century, but it was revealed in the Qur'an. He is the knower of the unseen, whom not an atom's weight eludes, either in the heavens or in the earth, nor is there anything smaller or larger than that which is not in a clear book. In another verse, God tells us that not even an atom's weight eludes your Lord, either on earth or in heaven, nor is there anything smaller than that or larger which is not in a clear book. This verse refers to atom and smaller particles still. The fact that there are even smaller subunits was imparted to humanity in the Qur'an 14 centuries ago. The 20th century saw a great many new discoveries regarding celestial phenomena in the universe. One of these is the black hole. When a star has consumed all its fuel, it collapses in on itself, eventually turning into a region with infinite density and zero volume and an immensely powerful magnetic field. This is called a black hole. We are unable to see black holes, even with the most powerful telescope, because their gravitational pull is so strong that even light is unable to escape from them. Their presence, however, can be perceived by means of the magnetic effect they have on the surrounding area. In the Qur'an, God draws attention to this matter in this way. "And I swear by the stars' positions, and that is a mighty oath, if you only knew." All stars with large masses set up gravitational fields in space. A black hole constantly increases its density, and thus gravitational attraction, by drawing everything around it, or that passes by it, into itself. In this sense, it resembles a hole in space into which everything around it is pulled. That is why they are known as black holes. This information about stars in the Qur'an is also remarkable. "I swear by heaven and the Tariq, and what will convey to you what the Tariq is? The star piercing, the darkness." In one verse of the Qur'an, the fecundating characteristic of the winds and the resulting formation of rain are mentioned. "And we send the fecundating winds, then cause water to descend from the sky, therewith providing you with water in abundance." This fact set out in the Qur'an was definitely unknown until the beginning of the 20th century. Until then, the only relationship known between the wind and the rain was that it was the wind that drove the clouds. However, today's meteorological findings have demonstrated the fecundating role of the wind in the formation of rain. According to these findings, on the surface of oceans and seas, a large number of air bubbles form because of the water's foaming action. The moment these bubbles burst, thousands of tiny particles with a diameter of just 0.01 millimeter are thrown up into the air. These particles, known as aerosols, mix with dust carried from the land by the wind and are carried to the upper layers of the atmosphere. These particles, carried to higher altitudes by winds, come into contact with water vapor up there. Water vapor condenses around these particles and turns into water droplets. These water droplets first come together and form clouds, and then fall to the earth in the form of rain. In short, the formation of rain comes when winds fecundate the clouds with the aerosols, in just the same way it was revealed in the Qur'an, at a time when people knew next to nothing about natural phenomena. Research carried out in recent years has revealed that the prefrontal area, lying in the frontal part of the skull, is responsible for the management of particular functions of the brain. This area of the cerebrum is also responsible for planning, motivation, and initiating good and evil behavior, and it is responsible for telling lies and the truth. A book entitled Essentials of Anatomy and Physiology says, in relation to its involvement in motivation, the prefrontal area is also thought to be the functional center for aggression. Parallel information to these scientific facts discovered by scientists in the last 60 years was also imparted in the Qur'an 14 centuries ago. Know indeed, if he does not stop, we will grab him by the forelock, a lying, sinful forelock. The expression, the lying, sinful forelock, in this verse is most remarkable. This demonstrates a close parallel to the activities carried out in the front part of the brain. What determines the gender of an unborn child? According to the Qur'an, the answer lies in its father. Masculinity or femininity is created out of a drop of semen which has been ejected. Gender is determined by the sperm cells from the male, and that the female has no role in this process. The verses that tell us this read, he has created both sexes, male and female, from a drop of semen which has been ejected. Wasn't he a drop of ejaculated sperm, then an embryo which he created and shaped, making from it both sexes, male and female? The developing disciplines of genetics and molecular biology have scientifically validated the accuracy of this information given in the Qur'an. A baby's gender is determined by which chromosome, X or Y, from the male, unites with the female's ovum. None of this was known until the discovery of genes in the 20th century. Indeed, in many cultures, it was believed that the female determined the gender of a baby. This is one reason why women were blamed when they gave birth to girls. 14 centuries before human genes were discovered, however, the Qur'an revealed information that denies this superstition and referred to the origin of gender lying not with women, but with the semen deriving from men. That is because the Qur'an is the Word of God. When the sperm of the male unites with the ovum of the female, the essence of the baby to be born is formed. This single cell is known as a zygote. It will instantly begin reproducing by dividing and eventually become a piece of flesh called an embryo. The embryo, however, does not spend its developmental period in a void. It clings to the uterus, similar to roots that are firmly fixed to the earth by its tendrils. Through this bond, it can obtain the substances essential to its development from the mother's body. Here, an important miracle of the Qur'an is revealed. While referring to the embryo developing in the mother's womb, God uses the word alaq. Recite, In the name of your Lord who created man from Alaq. Recite, and your Lord is the most generous. The meaning of the word Alaq in Arabic is a thing that clings to some place. Certainly, the use of such a specific word for the embryo developing in the mother's womb proves once again that the Qur'an is the word of God, the Lord of all the worlds. Another important item of information provided in the verses of the Qur'an is the developmental stages of a human being in the mother's womb. We then form the drop in the embryo, and form the embryo into a lump, and form the lump into bones, and clothed the bones in flesh, and then brought him into being as another creature. Blessed be God, the best of creators. It is clearly stated in these verses that in the mother's womb, the bones develop first, and then the muscles form which wrap around them. Until very recently, embryologists assumed that the bones and muscles in an embryo developed at the same time. Yet research conducted by virtue of new technological developments has yielded such accurate conclusions. These researched findings are just as it is described in the Qur'an. First, the cartilage tissues of the embryo ossifies. Then, muscular cells that are selected from amongst the tissue around the bones come together and wrap around the bones. This event is described in a scientific publication titled Developing Human in the following words. The shape of the skeleton determines the general appearance of the embryo in the bone stages during the seventh week. Muscles do not develop at the same time, but their development follows soon after. The muscles take their positions around the bones throughout the body, and therefore clothe the bones. Thus, the muscles take their well-known forms and structures. The stage of clothing with muscles occurs during the eighth week. In short, developmental stages of man, as described in the Qur'an, are in perfect harmony with the findings of modern embryology. Emeritus Professor Keith Moore of the Department of Anatomy and Cell Biology at the University of Toronto is one of the eminent embryologists in the world. He is one of those scholars who have identified this miracle in the Qur'an. Professor Moore examined the verses concerning human birth and announced his conclusions in these words. It has been a great pleasure for me to help clarify statements in the Qur'an about human development. It is clear to me that these statements must have come to Prophet Muhammad from God, or Allah, because most of this knowledge was not discovered until many centuries later. This proves to me that Prophet Muhammad must have been a messenger of God, or Allah. All that we have seen in the scientific miracles of the Qur'an films shows us one clear fact. The Qur'an is such a book that all the information it contains has been and is being found to be true. Facts about scientific subjects, facts that no one could have known at the time of the Qur'an's revelation, are announced in its verses. It is impossible for such information to have been known with the level of knowledge and technology available in 7th century Arabia. This, of course, is manifest proof that the Qur'an cannot be the word of man. In the Qur'an, God tells us the following. this Qur'an could never have been devised by any besides God. Rather, it is confirmation of what came before it and an elucidation of the book, which contains no doubt from the Lord of all the worlds. Do they say he has invented it? Say, then produce a surah like it, and call on anyone you can besides God if you are telling the truth. The Egyptian ruler known as Pharaoh and his court were highly devoted to their polytheistic system and idolatrous beliefs. Indeed, according to their perverted beliefs, Pharaoh was actually a deity himself. At this time, God sent Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, as his messenger to the people of Egypt. Pharaoh, however, responded with slanders and threats to Prophet Moses' calls for him to believe in God. This arrogant attitude lasted until he was faced with God's punishment. He was faced with the threat of death through drowning. The position of Pharaoh, who turned to faith at just that moment, is described in these terms in verses. We brought the tribe of Israel across the sea, and Pharaoh and his troops pursued them out of tyranny and enmity. Then, when he was on the point of drowning, he said, I believe that there is no deity but him in whom the tribe of Israel believes. I am one of the Muslims. However, this last-minute conversion was not accepted. What now? When previously you rebelled and were one of the corruptors? Today we will preserve your body so you can be a sign for people who come after you. Surely many people are heedless of our signs. The information that Pharaoh's corpse would serve as a sign for later generations may be regarded as an indication that his body would not decay. On display in the Royal Mummy's Chamber of the Egyptian Museum in Cairo is the body of Pharaoh, just as it was revealed 14 centuries ago. We decreed in the book for the tribe of Israel, you will twice cause corruption on earth, and you will reach a degree of great haughtiness. When the promised first time came, we sent against you servants of ours possessing great force, and they ransacked your houses, rampaging right through them. It was a promise that was fulfilled. Then, once again, we gave you the upper hand over them, supplied you with more wealth and children, and made you the most numerous group. As these verses reveal, the children of Israel caused two corruptions over the world. The first one is when they killed Prophet John and set a trap to kill Prophet Jesus, peace be upon them both. They were exiled shortly afterwards from Jerusalem by the Romans in 70 and wandered all over the world. When that verse was revealed to the prophet, the Jews were living in various countries and had no state of their own. Yet, God told in the verses that one day the children of Israel would recover their strength, At that time, however, there seemed to be almost no way this would really happen. Many centuries later, however, this event revealed by God in the verses came true. The Jews returned to Palestine and established the State of Israel in 1948. Subsequently, the attitudes of some racist circles living in Israel led to disorder in the Middle East. This current state is a sign of the children of Israel's second corruption. However, it is important to note that this wicked behavior certainly does not apply to all Jews, for many Jews are individuals of good conscience and common sense who do not agree with such behavior. Certain racist and radical circles need to take to forgiveness as recommended by our Lord. If they follow this path, then it is clear that by God's will, an environment of peace and brotherhood can again be established. For the Qur'an states, "A good action and a bad action are not the same. Repel the bad with something better, and if there is enmity between you and someone else, he will be like a bosom friend." One of the important points in the verses in Surat al-Isra regarding the children of Israel is the way they state that events which appeared impossible at the time and for which there was not the slightest indication to ever take place would come to pass in the future. The fact that all this information was imparted centuries ago is of course one of the miracles of the Quran. Humanity's exploration of space was accelerated with the Soviet satellite Sputnik on 4 October 1957, whose successful launch NASA considers as the dawn of the space age. The first man to leave the Earth's atmosphere was the Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, who entered space in the craft Vostok 1 in 1961. Human beings set foot on the moon on 20 July 1969 with the American Apollo 11 mission. In fact, it was revealed in the Quran that such developments and achievements would one day be realized. And this was revealed 14 centuries before, at a time when there were no spacecrafts equipped with advanced technology. O company of jinn and human beings, if you are able to pierce through the confines of the heavens and earth, pierce through them. You will not pierce through except with a clear authority. Careful examination reveals that the verse emphasizes that humanity will be able to move into the depths of earth and sky, but only with a superior power. In all likelihood, this superior power is the superior technology employed in the 20th century. In fact, these tidings imparted by God in the Quran took place thanks to 20th century advanced technology. This Quran is not a narration which has been invented, but confirmation of all that came before, a clarification of everything, and a guidance and a mercy for people who believe. It is a now common known fact that the earth rotates. The Qur'an clearly describes the direction of that rotation. These facts are revealed in these terms in the Qur'an, sent down in the 7th century when the earth was thought to be flat and resting on the back of an ox. You will see the mountains and reckon them to be solid, but they go past like clouds, the handiwork of God who gives to everything its solidity. He is aware of what you do. The verse emphasizes how the mountains, and therefore the earth itself, moves in the same way that clouds do. The direction of movement of the main cloud masses at some 4,000 meters high is always from west to east. This direction is the same as that in which the earth rotates around its own axis. Therefore, it is miraculously revealed in the verse that the earth moves from west to east, the same direction as followed by the clouds. And what is more, this was revealed 1400 years before the present day, at a time when people did not believe that the earth was round, that it revolved around its own axis, and that it traveled from west to east. For hundreds of years, people imagined that the world was flat. Its true shape only came to light through the use of technological means. Our planet is round, but not completely spherical, however. Its shape is that of an ellipse, slightly flattened at the poles and slightly bulging at the equator. This unique shape of the Earth is described as geoid and was only discovered in the last few hundred years. Yet this special shape of the Earth is clearly set out in the Qur'an. The verse in question reads, "After that, he smoothed out the earth." In the above verse, the word daha is used in the original Arabic. The choice of this word to describe the earth is particularly striking, because daha stems from the Arabic word dahu, which word is used to describe the action of adjusting or smoothing something out in a spherical manner. For example, words derived from that root are also used for the place where an ostrich lays its eggs and the egg itself. Indeed, our earth bears a very close resemblance to a geoid-shaped ostrich egg. The use of the word daha contains important information about the shape that God has given to the earth. There is no doubt that the way attention is drawn to these facts in the Qur'an, at a time when people's knowledge concerning the universe was very limited, is a manifest proof that it is the Word of God. How the process of photosynthesis begins in the morning. Plants are the source of the oxygen we breathe. They store solar energy in the form of foodstuffs that human beings and animals can make use of. This mechanism is known as photosynthesis. During the process of photosynthesis, plants take carbon dioxide from the air and give off oxygen in its place. They require sunlight in order to do this. Oxygen, which we breathe, is the main product of photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is a system based on difficult to understand chemical formulae and very delicate balances involving numbers and units of weight so small that one never encounters them in daily life. This process cannot be observed with the naked eye because the process employs electrons, atoms, and molecules. For millions of years, plants have been producing the oxygen, nutrients, and energy we need by means of photosynthesis, which was discovered in the 1700s, and many of whose mechanisms have still not been unraveled. The productivity of photosynthesis is measured by the level of oxygen output. The greatest point is in the morning, when the sun's rays are most concentrated. This important fact is indicated in these terms in a verse from the Qur'an. And I swear by the night when it draws in, and by the dawn when it breathes in. The term ita tanafasa in these verses is a metaphorical reference to breathing, respiration, or breathing deeply. The expression, and by the dawn when it breathes in, miraculously indicates that the production of oxygen, an essential component of our respiratory systems, begins in the morning. Years ago, people were naturally unaware that plants used sunlight to produce oxygen by means of photosynthesis, and that this process began in the morning. Yet, our omniscient Lord reveals this in the Qur'an, using a most wise style to do so. The star Sirius is the brightest star in the night sky. Astronomers have calculated its distance from us at being 8.5 light years. It was noted only in very recent times, thanks to modern telescopes, that Sirius moves together with another star, much smaller than itself, and invisible to the naked eye. Scientists call this two-star system Sirius A and Sirius B. The larger of these is Sirius A, which is the brightest star that can be seen with the naked eye. Its mass is 3 times that of the Sun, and it is 10 times brighter than it. Sirius B, on the other hand, is a white dwarf star. It cannot be seen with the naked eye. It possesses approximately the same mass as the Sun, although since its diameter is only 4 times that of the Earth, it is very much more dense. The stars in the Sirius system are heading towards our direction at thousands of kilometers an hour. The duration of the rising of Sirius on Earth's horizon is exactly the same as our solar year. In other words, 365 days and 6 hours. Because they had discovered this interesting common feature in the star Sirius and the solar system, the ancient Egyptians declared the day when Sirius first appeared on the horizon to be the first day of their calendar year. Because of such characteristics, the star Sirius became a focus of interest for a great many ancient civilizations. It was believed that this star possessed various powers, and some people even went to such excesses in their depravity as to worship it. The fact is, though, that it is God, the Lord of the worlds, who created the star Sirius and all the features it possesses, just as he did everything else. God refers to Sirius, known as Shi-Ra in Arabic, in verse 49 of Surat An-Najm of the Qur'an. It is he who is the Lord of Sirius. The Sirius double stars orbit in ellipses around one another. The orbital period of Sirius A and B about their common center of gravity is 49.9 years. This scientific data is today accepted with one accord by the Departments of Astronomy at Harvard, Ottawa, and Leicester Universities. This information is reported as followed in various sources. Sirius, the brightest star, is actually a twin star. Its orbit lasts 49.9 years. As is known, the star Sirius A and Sirius B orbit each other in a double bow every 49.9 years. The point requiring attention here is the double, bow-shaped orbit of the two stars around one another. We've seen that the star Sirius is referred to in Surat An-Najm, verse 49. We also encounter a very wise analogy in verse 9 of the same surah. He was 2 bow lengths away, or even closer. As we have seen this far, the star Sirius is referred to in verse 49 of the surah. And verse 9 of the same surah contains the expression, 2 bow lengths, to refer to the two stars' orbits. When we combine the numbers of these two verses, in other words 49 and 9, we obtain the number 49.9, the duration in years of these stars' orbits. Here we are faced with a mathematical miracle of the Qur'an. Given the technological means available 1400 years ago, it was of course impossible for people living then to know that the star Sirius, one of which is too small to be seen with the naked eye, was actually a two-star system, that both these stars' orbits were in the form of a bow, and that those orbits lasted for 49.9 years. Scientists only came by that information towards the end of the 20th century. Yet our Almighty Lord, the creator of everything from nothing, the absolute ruler, has miraculously revealed these facts in the Qur'an, and God knows best. This scientific fact that nobody could have known at the time of the revelation of the Qur'an once again proves that the Qur'an is the word of Almighty God. All that we have seen in this film shows us one clear fact. The Qur'an contains no discrepancies. It comes from the presence of our Lord. The scientific subjects mentioned in the Qur'an accounts from the past or the future, and its mathematical order contain facts that nobody at the time could have known. It was impossible for those facts to be obtained at the level of science and technology of the time. This, of course, is clear proof that the Qur'an cannot possibly be the word of a human being. It is the revelation of God and has been preserved unaltered since it was first imparted to us. Say, if both men and jinn banded together to produce the like of this Qur'an, they could never produce anything like it, even if they backed each other up. The Qur'an is the word of God, who created all things from nothing, and whose knowledge enfolds all entities. Our duty is to cling tightly to this divine scripture revealed and to adopt it as our guide. And this is a book we have sent down and blessed. So follow it and have fear and respect so that hopefully you will gain mercy.